students, welcome to the physics class. Today we will discuss about the vector form of Ohm's law or Ohm's law in microscopic form. To do that, my dear students, if you remember, the relation between current and drift velocity was like this: I equals to N into E into A into Vd, where N is the number of electrons per unit volume, is the amount of charge of a single electron, A is the area of cross section of the conductor, and Vd is the drift velocity of the electron. Now from this relation, suppose in a conductor, if the length of the conductor be L, okay, so if the length of the conductor be L and potential difference across the conductor be V, so the electric field intensity which is set up by the conductor is V by L. Fine. Now, as the charge of an electron is E, so the force experienced by this electron when kept in this electric field will be F equals to charge into electric field intensity, so small e into capital E. This is the force experienced by a single electron when kept in an electric field of electric field intensity E. So if you put the value, E into E by L. Now if this force causes an acceleration A in that electron, and if M be the mass of the electron, then I can write in place of F, mass into acceleration is equals to E into V by L. So from this, what we are getting, A equals to E V by L. So this is the acceleration which is produced in an electron kept in a electric field of intensity E, or given by a potential difference V, mass M, and the length of the conductor L. So I need this equation in future, so I will write it here. Fine. Now, my dear students, as you know, that when an electron is accelerated by an external field, then what happens due to the collision with the positive ions, it doesn't get a constant acceleration. Normally, electrons, they move around with the velocity, their thermal velocity. Suppose for an electron, let that be U1. This is the velocity of the electron for thermal agitation. Now when this particular electron is applied by an external electric field, as we have seen, it experiences a force, and for that force there is an increment in the velocity, there is an increase in the velocity of the electron. So the amount of velocity which gets increased, how to get that? So acceleration equals to change in velocity by time. So change in velocity will be acceleration into time. Now here time means time between two successive collisions, which is denoted by relaxation time tau. So here V equals to A into tau, right? So suppose for an electron whose thermal velocity is U1, means this is in absence of any external field, and in presence of external field, its velocity got increased by this amount. So the total velocity of an electron in presence of the field becomes for one electron. For second electron, it will be like this. For third electron, so it will go on like this. So this is the amount of velocity which is getting increased. So the final velocity is becoming like this. Now the average velocities of n electrons, the average velocities of n electrons is given by the drift velocity of the electrons. And what is that? So the average velocity of n electrons is given by the drift velocity Vd. How to write? So for the first electron, this is okay. For the second electron, this is the total velocity. Like this, it will go on up to n number divided by n. So you can write, for example, here u n plus a tau n. So I can write this equation like this. So I can write these equations like this. Now this denotes this u1 plus u2 plus un divided by n. This denotes the average thermal velocities of electrons, which is 0. We have learned in the previous class. The average thermal velocity of electrons, 0. So this Vd becomes A into, now this tau1 plus tau2 plus tau n by n, this gives the average relaxation time of n electrons given by tau. So A into tau, which is average relaxation time of n electrons. Okay, fine. So Vd equals to A into tau. I'll start from here. The expression which we have got of the drift velocity of the electrons as Vd is equals to A into tau. Now see the value of A, Eb by ml. So I'll put the value of that. So this is the expression of Vd we are getting, correct? Well, from this, now as we know, I equals to, from this equation, n into A into E into Ve. Now put the value of Vd here. So n into E into A into Vd means E into V into tau by m into L. Now from this, if I simplify the equation, I get as n square A tau into V by m into L. From this, if I do V by I, what I will get? I will get m into L by n into E square into A tau. And V by I means R. So what we are getting, R equals to m into L by n into E square into A into tau. So this is also the expression of resistance in terms of number of electrons and average relaxation time. So here we can see R is inversely proportional to number of electrons and also average relaxation time. So from this I can get this two, R proportional to 1 by n and R proportional to 1 by tau. These two relations we are getting from here. That means if the average relaxation time increases, resistance decreases. If average relaxation time decreases, resistance of a conductor increases. Similarly with the number of electrons. So I will remember this value, so I am writing this here. R equals to ml by n square A into tau. Now if we talk about resistivity, if you remember in last class, we have studied that R equals to rho into L by A, right? Let's see how to get it. Resistivity in terms of electric field intensity and current density can be written as rho equals to E by J, where E is the electric field intensity and J is the current density. So rho is defined by, so E equals to again what? V by L. And J equals to what? I by A, current by area. So from this, or rho equals to what we get? V by L divide I by A. So what we get? V by I into A by L. Now this V by I means R. So you get R into A by L. So rho equals to, I am getting R into A by L. Fine. Similar, but same as it is. Now if I put the value of R in terms of this tau and N, what we will get? In place of R, I am putting M into L by N into E square into A into tau. I am putting the value of R from here and into A by L. So these two cancels out. So what we get? M by N E square tau. This is the resistivity, expression of resistivity of a material. Now, the reciprocal of resistivity, specific resistivity, is specific conductivity, which is given in terms of sigma. Sigma equals to 1 by rho. This also we have learnt in our last class. So 1 by rho, if you put, what comes? N is square tau by M. This is one relation. Again, as sigma equals to 1 by rho, and rho equals to E by J. So I can write from here, sigma equals to J by E. Just opposite to this inverse. Or J equals to sigma into E. Now as electric field density and current density, they both are vectors. So I can write like J vector equals to sigma into E vector. This is the vector form of Ohm's law. This is clear to you. In my next topic, I am going to discuss about electrical power and energy. Another thing, my dear students, if you bend the wire at many places in a conductor or in a wire, if you bend more than one or two parts, its resistance will not change, because resistivity will not change, because resistivity depends on N and tau. So for bending, number of electrons and average relaxation time do not change. Both of them do not change. Why? Because electrons have negligible inertia, so their drift velocities do not change, and as drift velocities do not change, the relaxation time also remains unchanged. So next we are going to discuss about electric power. Power and energy, both. For this, a simple electric diagram we need. Dear student, this is a battery. You can give a switch here anywhere. This is a black box. Black box means there is a motor. Can be inside the black box, there can be a motor. There can be a battery, which a storage cell kind of thing. Means across which I will get a potential drop. There is some resistance present inside it. A load, you can say. Now, if I current flows through this black box, and if R be the resistance here, which is applied inside the black box, so as per Ohm's law, V equals to IR. That we know. Now, the amount of work done in moving a positive charge through this black box, that will be given as W equals to, so Q into V. Okay, W equals to Q into V. V is the potential difference, Q is the amount of charge which I am moving, W is the work done. Again, Q equals to, if I is the current and for T time it is flowing, Q equals to I into T. So from here W equals to V I T. Okay, and this work done comes out as heat energy which is produced inside it. It comes as heat in form of heat energy. So V I T, if this product if I write V into I into T. So in place of V, I can put IR, this equation. So it can be written as I square R into T. In place of V, I am putting IR. Or W equals to, also can be written in place of I. In place of I can put V by R. So it becomes V square by R into T. Both are same, but in different forms. Okay. Unit, the unit of energy is here joule. All are in joule. Okay. Now, if I talk about power, power is defined as the rate at which the energy is transformed into other forms. So, rate of use of energy or rate of dissipation of energy. So, power is defined as W by T. Expression of W, if you remember, we have got VIT by T. So PT cancels out, so V into I. This is another example. Voltage into current, potential difference, drop into current is equals to power. Unit is, so watt or symbol you can write like this. Unit of volt, joule per coulomb. Unit of I, ampere. Ampere means coulomb per second. So coulombs cancel out. This also means joule per second. Okay, fine. Next, this term I can write if I put V into I. So if in place of V I put IR from Ohm's law, so it will become I square R. In place of V, I am putting IR. Also, it can be written as, in place of I, if I put, in place of I have to put V by R. So, it will come V into I, in place of I am putting, so V square by R. Okay? So, these are the equations. So, what is the unit? The unit of power is watt or joule per second. Remember, these equations are only valid when the electrical energy is transformed into heat energy only, no other form. The electrical energy, if the electrical energy gets converted to heat energy, then these formulas, whatever I have written, they all are valid formula. Now, the consumption of electrical energy in our daily life or in our household circuit, they are measured in board of trade unit or simply kilowatt hour. Kilowatt is the bigger unit of watt. 1 kilowatt equals to 1000 watt. So 1 kilowatt hour, I can write like this. So 1 kilowatt into 1 hour. 1 kilowatt means 10 to the power 3 watt. Into 1 hour means 36 into 10 to the power 2 seconds. So I can write like this equation as 3.6 into 10 to the power 6 watt second. A watt second means joule. So it comes as 3.6 into 10 to the power 6 joule. Now 10 to the power 6 joule means mega joule. So it comes as 3.6 mega joule. So 1 kilowatt hour equals to 3.6 mega joule. Clear? And this 1 kilowatt hour is also known as 1 unit. Right? This is 1 unit, 1 kilowatt hour. Well, now we will discuss about the color codes of the resistances. Color code. Color code of resistance. See, if I draw a diagram, you will understand clearly. Resistor, there are three bands painted over the resistor. One here, two here, and three here. Another band is there at the side, which is here. Now, depending on the colors which are painted over the resistor, we can find out by looking at the colors that what is the resistance that will be offered by the resistor. So for this, let me just mark this first band as A, second band as B, third band as C, and fourth band as D. These three bands gives the value of the resistance. And the fourth band gives the percentage reliability of the resistance, which is known as tolerance. Okay, this can be either silver or gold or no color. If gold is there, then the tolerance is 5%. If silver is there, the tolerance is 10%. If nothing is there, no color, then the tolerance is 20% around. Okay? So this is with the fourth band. Now the first three band, how to calculate? To easily remember this, let me tell you a formula so that you can remember easily. See what I am writing, BB Roy of slowing this part. Now these are actually, this will give you to, this will help you to remember the colors. This stands for black. Stands for brown, R stands for red, O stands for orange, this Y stands for yellow, G stands for green, this B stands for blue, V stands for violet, G stands for grey and W stands for white. Okay, this series of color you have to remember. Now, the value of A and B, what do they give? A and B gives the first two significant digits of the resistance in ohm. A and B, A color and B color give the first two significant digits of the resistance in ohm, and C gives the power of 10 by which these two digits will be multiplied. C gives the power of 10 by which these two significant digits will be multiplied. I am showing you with one example. So for this, value of these significant digits, for black this is taken as 0, for blue 1, brown 1, for red 2, orange 3, yellow 4, green 5, blue 6, violet 7, gray 8, and for white the value of is 9. So A and B, you have to put the value according to color. If suppose A is brown in color and B is orange in color, so it will be the two significant digits for brown and orange are 1 and 3. So AB will be 1 and 3. Okay, for example. And C gives the power of 10. Suppose for a color code I am explaining, suppose these three colors of a resistor, color resistor, given brown, color code of a resistor, brown, first color is brown, second color is yellow, third color is given as blue, and the fourth color is given as, suppose, gold. These are the four colors of the band of one unknown resistor we have got. Now I have to find the value of the resistance. Achha, the value of C for these colors, if these are the colors of valve C, so if C is of black color, then it will be multiplied by 10 to the power 0. If C is of brown color, it will be multiplied by 10 to the power 1. If it is of red color, the C is of red color, then AB will be multiplied by 10 to the power 2. If C is orange color, then value of AB will be multiplied by 10 to the power 3. Like this, the multiplier will go on. These are the values by which it will be multiplied. So for this color combination, if I have to find out, see for A, so first brown, if the color is brown, the value, the significant digit is 1. So first I will put 1. Actually, how to find out? A, B into C plus minus D. Okay? Let us check. So 1 for brown. Next color, yellow. B color is yellow. So yellow is 4. So 1 into 4 into third color, C, that is blue. Blue means into 10 to the power 6. Plus minus, you have to write with this. Gold is, how much I have told you, remember, 5%. Tolerance is 5%. So this ohm into plus minus 5%. This is the total resistance of this color combination. Another example if I give. Suppose for example if I write another color combination, orange. Then suppose violet. And suppose given gray, and nothing is there. So these three color combinations are given, and I have asked to find out the resistance by using this color combination. So first color is orange. For orange, what is the value? 3. So write 3. Then the color is violet. The violet gives 7. So 3 into 7 into 37 into. These are two significant digits. Don't multiply them. Just you write the numbers side by side. Significant digits 3, 7 into third color is gray. For gray the multiplier is 10 to the power 8 because the third color is the multiplier into 10 to the power 8 ohm. Now there is no fourth band. If there is no fourth band, that means no color. The tolerance is plus minus 20%. So that means the value of the resistance can vary 20% either this side or that side. It's all either more or less. So this is how you can easily calculate the resistance, the value of the resistance by looking at the color code of the resistance. Okay, so if you can try with any color code to find out the value of the resistance. By chance, if you see if there are three colors, no fourth band is given, that means you have to take the tolerance as 20%. And if the four bands are given, then for gold that is 5% tolerance, So you have to write by plus minus 5%. For silver, it is 10%. And if there is no color, that is 20%. Now, we will discuss another topic, which is the combination of resistances. The combination of resistors. Now, the resistors can be combined with each other in two ways. One is series and one is parallel. So first we will see what is the equivalent resistance of the resistors connected in series. Connecting in series means, suppose I have three resistances here which are connected in series like this, connected to a battery, and let I be the current which is flowing through this. The value of this is R1, the value of this resistance R2, and the value of this resistance is R3. One by one it is connected. Now the best part of the series is that same current flows through series connection. Means whatever resistors are connected in a series connection, the same current flows in each resistor. So what is the drop across these resistance? If current flows through this, there will be a drop. Suppose that is V1. The drop across this resistance, suppose that is V2. And the drop across this resistance, suppose that is V3. And this is the EMF or the battery which is provided, V, total drop. So the total drop must be equal to the individual drops. So from this, V is equal to V1 plus V2 plus V3. Now V1 means R1. As per Ohm's law, I current flows through resistance R1, so I1. V2 is I current, same current flows as I said, into R2, IR2. And V3 is I current flowing through R3, that is IR3. Now, in place of these three resistances, or these three resistors, if I consider a single resistor which will serve as the equivalent of these three resistances, so let that be this, suppose any, which is denoted by RS. RS is the equivalent resistance of the series combination of R1, R2 and R3. That time I can write this circuit will change like this. In place of three resistance, I will put the equivalent resistance in place of the three, which is denoted by RS. Now, as per this equation, V is the potential difference here, I current flowing through RS. So, V equals to I into RS. So, from all the sides, I cancels out. So, RS becomes R1 plus R2 plus R3. Got it? So, the resistances get added up when connected in series. If there are n number resistances, so it will go on like this up to Rn. Actually, if there are equal n number of resistances connected, suppose there are n number of resistances are connected in series, each one is having a value of R. So equivalent resistance Rs equals to, as you know, so all are R, so it will go like R plus R plus R, so it will go up to n terms. So what you will get? N into R. So resistance, equivalent resistance increases in series connection. Next, I will discuss about the parallel combination of resistances. Parallel combination of resistances, both the terminals are connected with each other, and this is given by a common potential difference. I current flows. Now, in parallel connection, what happens? Different current flows through different resistances, but the potential drop across all the resistances are same as they are connected in parallel. In series connection, same current was flowing through each resistor, but potential drops were different. But in parallel connections, different current flows through different resistances, but the potential drops across the resistances is all are same. So suppose this is R1, this is R2, this is R3. Suppose in this I1 current flows, in this I2 flows, in this I3 current flows. So all get added up here and again I current comes up. But the potential difference across R1 is V, R2 is V, and R3 is also V, same potential drop. So V for first, from first resistance if I see, V equals to I1 R1. The same drop will be there across R2, so V equals to I2 R2. Same drop across R3, so V equals to I3 R3. Fine. You can write like this also, V1, V2, V3. But as we know in parallel connection, V1 equals to V2 is equals V3 equals to V. Then you can write like this. So I1 equals to what? V by R1. I2 equals to V by R2. And I3 equals to V by R3. Fine. Three currents I am getting. Now, if I take an equivalent resistance in place of these three resistances, means if I take one resistance which will serve as the parallel combination of these three resistances, then the circuit gets simplified. We get like this, a circuit, and this is RP, parallel combination of the resistances. So now from this equation, V equals to I into RP, or I equals to V by RP. Fine. Now as we know, I equals to I1 plus I2 plus I3, because I got divided in three currents. So from this, I can write V by RP, value of I equals to value of I1. V by R1 plus V by R2 plus V by R3. So from this I can write 1 by RP as 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. This is the RP is the equivalent resistance of the combination R1, R2 and R3. So if there are n number of resistances, so it will go on till 1 by Rn. But if there are equal resistances, n number of equal resistances connected, so what will happen? So if there are n number of equal resistances connected, so 1 by Rp will be equals to 1 by R plus 1 by R, all are same, plus 1 by R, plus it will go into n terms, so that will become n by R. So RP becomes, the equivalent resistance becomes R by N. So as you can see, the value gets decreased. So in parallel combination, the equivalent value of the resistances is less than the any individual resistance. And if we also see the graph of series combination and parallel combination, if we also see the VI graph, plot like this, now this gives you RP, this is the series combination. Why? Because the slope of this graph is less than the slope of this graph. Now in a VI graph, one which is having more slope, that means the slope of VI graph gives you the resistance. So the curve which is having more slope, it is having more resistance. So this curve is actually having more resistance. So this denotes a series combination. And this curve having a lower slope giving us the parallel combination. So if question is like this, two graphs are given and you are asked to find, suppose A and B. it is written that A and B, these two graphs denotes parallel and series combination. Now write down which one with logic, that which one is series combination, denoting series combination, and which one is denoting parallel combinations. Okay, so I hope the topics which I have discussed today are clear to you. In next class, I'll